Today we want to welcome Jeffrey Veidlinger on the really celebrating the publication of In the Shadow of the Shtetl, a small town Jewish life in Soviet Ukraine. I very much wanted to do this event because Ukraine in many ways is personal to me. My mother was escaping in the white Russian pogroms of 1919, and I've also had a chance to do a lot of work in Kiev, Odessa, Kharkov, not Jewish work, but always finding time to work with see the Jewish community there. We all know that Ukraine's very much in the news now. There's full of discussion in the Anglo-Jewish press about anti-Semitism, sort of ideological perspectives versus those who say we have to find ways of bolstering and supporting the Jewish community. The other thing that's interesting to me is Jeffrey is a professor of the Joseph Brodsky Professor of Judaic Studies and History at the University of Michigan. And certainly when I was going to college, which is many, many decades ago, as you know, this was a backwater thing. You didn't have Jewish studies or Judaic studies. You might have had one course in Yiddish literature, and that was kind of de-emphasized once every 3 years, maybe. And I went to Temple University, which was not a place that lacked people who were interested in Yiddish stuff. So it's wonderful to see this change in America. This is not the only department of Judaic or Jewish studies. It's very much part of the academic canon now, and that's all to the good. And how it came about says something positive about our country, whatever our various criticisms might be. And so I think this is just absolutely wonderful. For me, this is a book of surprises. I thought I knew a lot, but I certainly didn't know about the current Shtetls and the late 20th century post-World War II Shtetl and into the 21st century in the Ukraine. It is a book that deals with complexity. So it's not just a simple story of totalitarianism. It's the counter of how survival occurs with an inefficient bureaucracy. And it also shows why the Shtetl in Ukraine, particularly in one area, but in other areas as well, remains vital. What Jeffrey Veidlinger has really done is he has navigated complexity to add to our knowledge, and with it, tell a much richer story. So let us welcome Jeffrey Veidlinger to Politics and Prose. This is the first time he's doing a book at Politics and Prose, and it's not going to be the last time because he's working on other books. But he is not new to Politics and Prose, and I'm sure he can tell you about that.
Thank you so much, David, for that wonderful introduction. Thank you, everybody, for coming out on this absolutely gorgeous Sunday afternoon. I'm pleased that you've all decided to come and spend a little bit of it inside here. As David mentioned, this is such a fantastic bookstore. I did my PhD here back in the 90s. I lived in Washington for about 7 years at Georgetown University. I did my PhD. Maybe not a place that one would associate with Yiddish culture, but nevertheless, one that gave me a fantastic education in Yiddish culture. And I see one of my great professors is actually right there, who I just noticed. So David Goldfrank, hi. Nice to see you. And thanks to everyone else for coming out. So, I used to enjoy coming up to this bookstore, and I even saw a few readings here, a few lectures here over the years, and it's great to be giving one of these myself. So the book is indeed called In the Shadow of the Shtetl, Small Town Jewish Life in Eastern Europe. And it came about really just by chance, in a way. About 12 years ago, I decided on a whim to travel to Ukraine with two Yiddish linguists who were traveling through small towns in Ukraine looking for Yiddish speakers in order to trace dialects and to see how Yiddish words change from town to town. Those Yiddish linguists were Dovid Katz and Dovber Kurler. Dovid Katz was a professor of Yiddish linguistics at the University of Lithuania. He was living in Lithuania for a while, and he'd been doing this since the 1980s. He'd been going around interviewing Yiddish speakers. And Dovber Kurler was a colleague of mine at Indiana University, where I was then working, and he was an expert on Ukrainian Yiddish, on the dialects of Ukrainian Yiddish. So he decided to go and try to continue that work and to do some new work on Yiddish dialects in Ukraine. And I thought, hey, this sounds like fun. I'll go along. And really, I didn't realize that it would turn into something where over the next 10 years, I would go several times a year, almost every year, to interview these Yiddish speakers. And in total, by the time the project was done, we'd interviewed about 400 Yiddish speakers in about 100 different towns, mostly in small towns throughout Ukraine, mostly in Ukraine, a little bit in Moldova, and then a few interviews also in Romania, Hungary, and Slovakia. We focused on small towns really for linguistic reasons because they were looking for people who hadn't moved that often. And we were looking particularly for people who were still living in the same towns that they were born, something that doesn't often happen in Eastern Europe, particularly that doesn't often happen among Jews in Eastern Europe who tended to move around. So we were looking for people who were still born in the same or are living in the same place that they were born. And these interviews consisted of two parts. For the first part, sometimes a couple hours, the Yiddish linguists would read words in Russian to the people we were interviewing, and they would respond with the word in Yiddish. And they would just go through this long list of words, Russian, Yiddish, and all that was, you know, very interesting to hear how the dialects change. But then the second part of the interview was a little different. It was a free speech segment of the interview. And the main purpose of that was just to solicit free Yiddish speech. And they would ask the people we were interviewing, you know, tell me about your life. Tell me about where you were born. Tell me about your family. Tell me about how you survived the war. Tell me about what you did after the war. And as I began to listen to these, to dozens of these stories, it occurred to me that really, we were getting a whole new take on Jewish life in the 20th century. The stories that I was hearing were absolutely remarkable stories that were unfamiliar to me. And I was a professional historian of Russian and East European Jewry. And still, I noticed that I was getting a completely new take on the Jewish experience in the 20th century. I started to listen not only to how they were talking, the linguistic details, but also to hear really what they were saying. So it was a story that I think has largely been neglected. In fact, it's been neglected in three whole different types of scholarship. Soviet historians have neglected the story because it told the story of Jewish life. And in Soviet historiography, the way the Soviet Union portrayed the experience of people during the war, they tried not to privilege different ethnic groups. So they pretended that everybody suffered the same. And this was the narrative. You know, in fact, about 28 million people were killed during World War II in the Soviet Union. About 2 million of those were Jews. So they said, you know, the Jewish experience was just part of this larger experience. And they never really highlighted the Jewish experience during the war. They never really spoke about the Holocaust as a distinct event from the Second World War. So the story that we were getting was a new story in Soviet history. It was also a new story, oddly enough, in Jewish history, because Jewish history tends to be presented as a history of moving out of the shtetl. There's all types of books called, you know, From the Shtetl to the Suburbs, From the Shtetl to Socialism. You know, the shtetl is kind of the Ur place, the place from which Jewish life originates, and then it's a story of upward mobility, where you leave the shtetl and you go somewhere else. And here I was getting the story of, hey, not everybody did that. Not everybody emerged out of the shtetl into some wider metropolitan, cosmopolitan world. There were a lot of people who remained in the shtetl. And this was new to me. I had grown up hearing about the shtetl from, you know, parents and grandparents and hearing the word shtetl, which, by the way, just means small town. It's simply a small town. That's why I subtitled the book Small Town Ukraine. And I didn't realize that the shtetl still existed after the war. I'd been taught that they completely were destroyed. And in fact, in a little small pocket of Europe, there remained some shtetls. They had been decimated. Many people had been killed, in fact, often about half the town in the areas that we were focusing on. But we found that there were still people living, there were still Jews living in these small towns after the war. And, you know, often people tell me, oh, my grandfather is from a small town, a small shtetl, but it doesn't exist anymore. And I say, you know, it exists. It's just changed names. There's new people living there. What had been Jewish shtetlech, Jewish shtetls, are now often Ukrainian towns. But the place still exists. The place wasn't wiped off the map. Just the population changed and the demographic changed. So it's a story that's been neglected by Jewish history, again, which is focused on upward mobility. And then it's also a story that's been neglected, I think, by Holocaust history. Most books on the Holocaust, although this is beginning to change, but most books on the Holocaust talk about the experience of the Holocaust as it took place predominantly in Poland. That's the experience of extermination camps, of labor camps, of sealed railway cars, of people being shipped across Europe in sealed railway cars. But the story of the Holocaust that we were hearing is a story that didn't have extermination camps. It had concentration camps and labor camps, but for the most part, the people who were living in the area that we were working on were killed close to home. And they were killed by people who knew them. They were killed by their neighbors. They were killed by people who continued to live in their communities afterwards. They weren't atomized. They were never put in these huge masses on train cars and shipped across Europe. They weren't put in extermination camps, but they survived on their own. Sometimes they survived in little ghettos that were established there. But even the ghettos that were established in this part of the area, this part of the world, this part of Europe, were different types of ghettos than the ghettos that we may imagine from the large ghettos in Warsaw and Lodz. They were much smaller ghettos, sometimes with only a couple hundred people in them, and they tended to just be barbed wire fences rather than walls. And what that meant is that the people living in the ghetto still had a relationship with those outside the ghetto. Ukrainian peasants, Ukrainian neighbors could still toss potatoes over the fences. People could occasionally get out of the ghettos and smuggle out and have relationships on the outside. They weren't as hermetically sealed as we think of in the conventional Holocaust story. So in this sense, I think the story that we saw was also largely neglected in Holocaust history, again, because of this emphasis on killing close to home and on killing by bullets. You know, another recent book was called The Holocaust by Bullets, about this type of the Holocaust. It's not the story of Auschwitz and the big concentration camps. So I was surprised when we started this work to see that these shtetls still existed. When Dov Berkerler and David Katz suggested that we do this expedition and that we go look for Yiddish speakers in small towns of Eastern Europe, I thought they were crazy. I thought there's just no way that we're going to find anybody. And in fact, we did find people. And, you know, I thought this shtetl was a completely mythical place. I thought it was an imaginary place. I pictured, you know, Marc Chagall paintings, and you know, I thought that there were going to be little people flying through the air and all that. I imagine the novels of, you know, Jonathan Safran Foer and Nicole Krauss, you know, wonderful novelist, but where the shtetl is something, you know, imagined in memory and nostalgia, but not something real, not something where there's real people, you know, living and still struggling on a day-to-day existence. I imagined Fiddler on the Roof. You know, I thought everyone was going to get up and sing and all that. And actually, a lot of people did get up and sing, but not the Fiddler on the Roof songs. And here, in this little corner of Eastern Europe, we found some intact communities. We found places where there were, after the war, still significant Jewish communities. The reason is, it's a little place in Europe called Transnistria. And Transnistria was the part of Ukraine that the Germans conquered. It's south of Kiev, if you can picture Ukraine, which maybe more of you can picture Ukraine now than you could have a few months ago. But if you can picture Ukraine, it's basically in between Kiev and Odessa. And it's a little slip of territory called Transnistria. And when the Germans occupied this territory in July 1941, they quickly turned it over to Romanian rule. And so the Romanians came in, and the Romanians were actually controlling this territory instead of the Germans. The Romanians were vicious and carried out large-scale massacres in places like Odessa, smaller-scale massacres in places like Tomaszpol, but they didn't try to exterminate the entire population. They allowed large segments of the population to live. And this meant they actually drew the line, the Germans drew the line between Romanian Transnistria and German Reichskommissariat Ukraine along the river Southern Bug. And the Southern Bug River, just a river, it wasn't an old political border or anything, it was just a river. And they said if you live on this side of the river, you're in Romania. If you live on this side of the river, you live in Germany. And that meant that villages that were only a few kilometers away had much higher survival rates if they were living in Romania. So towns that we were interviewing people in had survival rates of sometimes any 40, 60, sometimes even 80% of the population managed to survive the war. That means, of course, 40 to 60% of the town was killed, which is, you know, a terrible atrocity. But if you compare it to villages just 5 kilometers, 10 kilometers away on the other side of the river, where nobody survived the war, or where maybe 1, 2, 5% of the town survived the war, it's a radical difference. So this area of Transnistria still, certainly in the 1950s, had large communities, sometimes Jewish shtetls with several thousand people living in them, 5,000 people living in them. And even by the time we started doing the interviews around 2000, we could still find dozens of people, dozens of elderly Jews who remembered life before the war and could give us an entire narrative of their life in the shtetl. And we managed to find these people through a wide variety of means. We could go to synagogues and we could ask around if there's any Yiddish speakers. We could go to Jewish self-help organizations and communal help organizations and ask. We could also just ask on the street. You know, these are very small towns, and we could go up to elderly people we see on the street and say, hey, are there any elderly Jews living in town? And they would say, yeah, I'll take you to the Jew. And they would bring us to the Jew. And it's the type of place, you know, these are still small towns where you can do that. I remember one town in particular, actually. We asked if there were any elderly Jews in town, and somebody said, oh, yeah, there's an elderly Jewess who lives down here. And we said, you know, can you take us? And he said, yeah, sure. So he hopped on the van with us, and, you know, he traveled down. We went down. We were in downtown at this broad avenue, big statues of Lenin, and I think the street was called, you know, Karl Marx Street, and, yeah, still. And we drove down the street into this, you know, kind of ramshackle area, cobblestone streets, houses one on top of another, just like a Marc Chagall painting, but without people floating in the air. And he hops out of the car and starts yelling, Jewess! Jewess! And rapping on doors, going, you know, rapping on windows, actually, you know, looking for this woman. And, you know, I don't know if somebody were to do that in my neighborhood, I probably wouldn't be quite so happy. But, you know, he went rapping around, and sure enough, this woman, this elderly woman in her late 80s, 90s, comes out of her house, you know, with dressed in a very colorful dress, and is thrilled to see us and couldn't be happier to, you know, be telling us her story. And time and again, this is the message that we got, is that people came out thrilled to see us and thrilled to be telling us their story as though they'd been waiting there for 70 years for an international team of researchers with a camera crew to come into their town and, you know, tell us their story. So I'll tell you a little bit about what their story was. And it's not a particularly pretty story. You know, the oldest people that we interviewed were born about 1914. That's really about the oldest. And that meant that their earliest memories are of the pogroms of the Civil War. They may remember as a young child the Russian Revolution, and they may as young children remember the pogroms of 1919 to 1921. One fellow we interviewed in Tulchin, he told us about how when he was a baby, he was born in 1917, and when he was a baby, he was about a year and a half, he was 19 years old, and his whole family was murdered during a pogrom, and he was in his mother's arms, and he lifted up his arm and showed us a scar where the bullet that killed his mother ricocheted off him during one of these pogroms, and he was left in this grave, he was left in what was essentially a mass grave, to die, and then an Orthodox priest, actually a Polish priest, a Catholic priest from nearby, discovered him and brought him to an orphanage, brought him up for a little bit, and then returned him to some extended family of his that was living in Tulchin. So this is, you know, the earliest memories from the pogroms. When the civil war, the Russian, Ukrainian, Polish, everyone, civil war dies down around 1921, there's then a period of economic stagnation, also By the way, the Civil War is accompanied by war communism, which is a time when the communists came in and took away everybody's property. Jews in particular were heavily impacted by this because Jews tended to be artisans, they tended to be traders. They were the people who were most targeted by this new communist regime that wanted to take away private property, were the traders, the artisans, who were overwhelmingly Jews. Then there's a period of economic stagnation for a while in the 1920s and economic catastrophes in the small towns of Ukraine. Late 1920s, the Soviet government decides that it's going to try to solve these problems. And how does it do it? But through collectivization, which means sending in tens of thousands of commissars to confiscate the peasants' property. Peasants respond often by destroying the property, by fighting back. At the same time, the communists start to arrest the priests, they arrest rabbis, they arrest authority figures, they arrest people suspected of Zionism in the shtetl. So there's this whole period of turmoil. And that's followed immediately by the great Ukrainian famine, the Holodomor, in which about 3.5 million people are killed in Ukraine alone, many of whom are Jews. And so they suffer through this famine. Not only are Jews killed during the famine, not only do they die during the famine, but often they're blamed for the famine because many people associate communist rule with the Jews. They look around, they see Trotsky, Zinoviev, Kamenev, Kaganovich, who was the communist, the head of the party in Ukraine, and they see these Jewish faces on a local level. They saw that the head of the regional party was Jewish. So they think, oh, you know, all Jews are communists. And so not only are Jews suffering from communism, but they're also getting blamed for it. Then that's the Great Famine, 31. There's then Stalin's Great Terror in the late 1930s, another wave of arrests. As this wave of arrests is dying down, there's a war in Finland. Several of the people that we spoke to got drafted into the army, go up to Finland, fight in Finland. Then they finish the Finnish campaign, they come back, and guess what happens? Germany invades on June 22nd, 1941, beginning what we now call the Holocaust. And during this time, many of them survive. The people that we interview survive through a variety of means. Sometimes they survive by fleeing east. They manage to get word of what the Germans are doing. And so they flee into Uzbekistan or Kazakhstan or as far east as they can get. Some of them survive by being laborers and by living under this Transnistria, under Romanian rule, where they can survive as laborers or be put in ghettos. Some of them survived by hiding out. We interviewed one person who simply hid in a wheat field for months at a time. He hid in a frozen wheat field for months at a time. And he told us that this family, Ukrainian family, managed to hide him and let him, you know, live in this wheat field, him and I think it was 5 or 6 other members of his family. And they would come out in the winter to get food. And they would go out on these frozen wheat fields. And he told us they would walk around in circles like this when they were trying to get food so that their footsteps couldn't be traced back to their hiding spot under the ground. And he basically lived out the winter in this wheat field. And one day he and his brother were out foraging for food. And they came back and they saw that the hiding place had been destroyed and the whole family had been killed. That one of the peasants who was helping hide them out had decided he'd had enough of helping this family. It was time to turn them in. So he turned them in, and the rest of his family was killed, and then they came looking for him and his brother. They expected to find 7 people. They only found 5. So he and his brother ran off. He tells us he had a vision. He was going to run into the forest. Instead, he had a vision where he says the Messiah came to him, and the Messiah said, "Don't run into the forest, run into the fields." So he ran into the fields. The Germans came to the forest, and he survived by running into the fields. So he says, you know, the frozen wheat fields of Ukraine, they saved him twice. They saved him first by giving him sanctuary underneath, and then they saved him when the Messiah came and told him to flee into them. So anyway, these people then, you know, live through the war. The war ends. They return to their homes. They think that everything's going to be great, or they hope that everything's going to be great. And instead, they encounter completely destroyed communities. They have to rebuild. They're no longer welcome in their homes. They see that when they left, where they were maybe, you know, in hiding or out of the shtetl, and their neighbors came and their neighbors took over their homes and say, well, now you can't come back. And Soviet law says if you've left your home for 6 months, then you lose your right to it. Somebody else can reclaim it. So they have to take these to the cases, and there's all types of legal things going on. Then their synagogues are closed, and they're in another period of economic stagnation. So suffice it to say, it's a very difficult life from beginning to end. And it just really does go one horror after another. In some ways, it's not a pretty story. But on the other hand, you know, when I ask them what they've learned or, you know, what I've learned from their stories, is that often they don't allow these stories to define themselves. And in the midst of this very difficult life, you can see how individuals have struggled, how individuals put things together, how they continue to live life. You know, I was always very interested in how they could go back to these towns and live with the people who stood by. Some people did help them, make no mistake about it. And most of those who survived did survive because some locals were helping them. But other locals were collaborating. Other locals were standing by and doing nothing. And they came back and they lived with them. And they worked in the same offices as people who had stood by or collaborated and, you know, managed for 60 years like that. And you realize that, in a way, time heals a little bit, just a little bit. People who left the shtetl, you know, people who left the shtetl during the World War II, in a way, left during its very worst day. When I think about people who came out and went to move to the United States, say, who left the Polish shtetls and then moved to the United States, they left at its very worst day. They left at the midst of this violence. They never had the chance to rebuild with other people in the shtetl, to work together with other people in the shtetl, and to see that they suffered as well. The Jews who came back saw that, yes, they had suffered a distinct fate. No, make no mistake about it. The Nazis targeted the Jews, and the Romanians targeted the Jews, and Jews suffered like nobody else. But their neighbors had also suffered. The Ukrainians in whose midst they were living had also had their homes bombed and their homes destroyed. And they had also starved and died of typhus. The typhus epidemics that killed so many Jews there weren't restricted to the Jews. They also spread. That everybody suffered. The Jews, yes, they suffered more. But everybody else did too. And this communal project of rebuilding, I think, plays a role in, you know, healing may be an overstatement, but plays a role in allowing for some type of continued life, for some type of reconciliation, this notion that everybody suffered. I also realized that people make their own memorials, that people have their own ways of remembering. In the Soviet Union, they weren't allowed to erect huge monuments commemorating the Holocaust. They weren't allowed to have these public memorials. So people remember in their own ways. And this is a big part of what the book is about, is how people reconstruct their past and how they remember. One woman that we interviewed had survived a massacre. She'd actually been in a mass grave and pulled herself out of the mass grave. And she remembered one family that was completely killed in this massacre. And she told us the father used to always sing a song. And so she sings that song to remember the father. And she sung us that song. And you can see that the song has so much in it. Her singing the song is a way of her remembering and honoring these people who were killed. Another person we interviewed had told us that he survived because his mother put in a loaf of bread right before she was taken, and he was a little boy at the time, and said, whatever you do, watch the bread to make sure that it doesn't burn. And it gave him some, he tells us, this is his version of the story, he tells us that he was watching the bread and that he was so intent on watching the bread that somehow he didn't come out when he was supposed to and he managed to survive the massacre. And so he says as a result, he bakes bread all the time in honor of his mother, and that the baking bread is his way of remembering and his honoring his mother. Others talk about gefilte fish. And actually, a lot of people, in the book has a lot of recipes for gefilte fish. Gefilte fish keeps coming up. People always want to feed us gefilte fish. I've eaten more gefilte fish than I care to admit. But the making of gefilte fish, everybody says that they make it exactly like their mother made it. It's their mother's recipe. And you realize that for them, making the gefilte fish like their mother made it is a way of remembering their mother. This is a society that allowed them very few ways of maintaining tradition. They weren't allowed to practice their religion, like their parents were. They weren't allowed to do the occupations that their parents had. People who had been tailors for generations and generations were no longer allowed to be tailors. They now had to work in the factory. But one of the things that you could do that had been done for generations and generations is make gefilte fish. You can have these memories that are passed on from generation, these recipes that are passed on from generation to generation, and, you know, even pulling carrots for the gefilte fish out of the very same garden that your mother pulled carrots from and that her mother pulled carrots from and her mother pulled carrots from. So it's this idea of having grabbing on to whatever you can for tradition. The holidays are the same way. People talk about celebrating the holidays, and you realize they're celebrating holidays for the sake of tradition, because that's what their parents did, that's what their grandparents did, and this is one way that they can hold on to memories. Another thing I learned is that memory is localized, and that people interpret their events locally. The way historians tend to write about history, we look at government orders, and we see how government orders are implemented over time, and we read, you know, one order after another, and we can put everything in context, and we can see that when Maria Yakuta, a woman that we interviewed, when her uncle Chotzko was arrested because he had a goat, we can see that that was part of the dekulakization campaign, that he was arrested because there was a larger campaign to take away things from the rich peasantry. But you realize that for Maria, all she knew is that her beloved husband, where they used to get milk from because he had a goat, was suddenly taken away. And she doesn't understand that it's part of a broader project and where it's all coming from. And you realize that people interpret things locally. People are also very reluctant to ascribe agency to some distant power. They like to think that they had a role in what was happening, and they tend to explain things, again, through a local context. And another thing I learned, and that I try to get across in the book, is that memory is in many ways subjective. People remember atrocities and they remember traumatic memories, and we can actually triangulate that with a whole bunch of other sources, and I can see that many of the massacres and many of the individual episodes that people are describing happened and are corroborated by other sources. That's not a problem. But it's the routine memory, it's how you reflect back on your life, is very contextual. And I think about this with one particular example. There was one woman we were interviewing, also in her 90s, and she was talking about her life and talking about life before the war and how wonderful it was, how the neighbors used to come and they were one big happy family, and they had, you know, they didn't have much to eat, but they had enough to eat, and everybody knew each other. There was no difference between Jews and non-Jews, and everybody was, you know, everybody was together. And her son, about 50 years old or so, big gruff guy, was sitting behind the camera listening to this. And he couldn't take it. He stood up and he said, "No, it wasn't. You were cold, you were miserable, you were lonely, and the whole community hated you." And she said, "No." And, you know, I thought, you know, what's this guy doing? How does he get the right to, you know, interrupt him? Where does he get off interrupting his mother and giving his mother's version of the story? And I realized what he's probably thinking is, I've spent my whole life listening to my mother complain about her childhood, and now this international camera, you know, team comes in and they're getting off easy. They're hearing that everything was good. They're not hearing her complain. And so he was angry about that, that we were getting the sanitized version of the story. And I think he wanted to give what he thought was the proper version of the story. But on the other hand, it also makes you realize that the mother, at this point, I guess, you know, in her 90s now, as she sits back and as she looks back on her life and as she tries to, you know, give what she knows is going into an archive and will go into a book, that this is how she wants her life to remember. And thinking back, you know, things maybe were good before the war. That in her perspective, you know, certainly compared to how they were after, that things, you know, were good. So these oral histories, they really, I think, illuminate the rhythms and textures of daily life, and they highlight the habitual. Historians often look at the extraordinary, when people come into contact. You know, traditional things that historians use, court cases, for instance, newspaper articles, these are the extraordinary. How often is an ordinary person in the newspaper? When you do something extraordinary. How often are you in a court case? When you do something extraordinary. But by speaking to people and by hearing these life stories, we get the ordinary. We get a sense of how they think back on their past, about how individuals structure their lives, how they construct narratives to understand the world around them, and how they give meaning to their own experiences. So I think all of this is in the book, I hope, along with some great photographs. And I think I'll stop there and take some questions. Thanks.
Thank you, Jeffrey. That was so rich and full of wonderful, special special history. You know the routine. We have two microphones on the side, and we'll rotate the microphones. And this is a public meeting, so if you're comfortable, please tell us your name. And we want to get all the questions in, so be as brief as you can.
Hi, I'm Carolyn Poplin. I'm a physician. That was wonderful. Is there a younger generation, or is this like we hear of places in Poland or Baghdad where there were terrible things happened and the Jews who came back saw what was there and left? Now, it was not so easy to leave the Soviet Union for Jews. Are there young people, or when these people are gone, will that be it?
So it's a complicated question, and one, you know, my interviews focused on the young people, so my scholarship's on the old people, so I'll answer just from my impression.
Sure.
And that is that there have been a lot of occasions where people have said this is the last generation, and every generation seems to be the last generation in some ways. The fact of the matter is, after the collapse of the Soviet Union, since even a little bit earlier, since 1989, there has been an enormous migration out of Ukraine.
Right.
And I believe, in fact, the majority of Jews have left Ukraine since then. But the community, there are some young people there, not so much in the small towns. They've moved now. They really have now moved to the bigger cities. But it's not to say that they're going to go, they're never going to go back to the little cities. To give one example, you know, I know somebody in a town, a young Jewish fellow who had lived in Israel for a while and learned some very good business skills in Israel and decided to come back to a small town, thought, hey, I can, you know, use what I've learned elsewhere, what I've learned in the West in Israel, and apply it here. And so he started a little business there and is doing quite well for himself. And there's other people who do that. You know, they come, they go to Israel, they live there for a little bit, or they come to America. And sometimes, not very often, but sometimes they decide to go back. And, you know, in the events of Ukraine of the last few months, the Jewish community has been very strong and very adamant, I think, in their support for the new government and very vocal in terms of that. And we'll see what happens in Ukraine. But if Ukraine, we'll see what happens. But if Ukraine becomes a, thriving democracy or something along those lines and becomes, joins the EU and does well, I don't think that's necessarily going to happen, but stranger things have happened in the last 20 years or so, then they may very well go back. These are people who have the language skills, who are able to, revive life there. So it's always, certainly, yes, there's very few young people that we interviewed, very few young people in these small towns. Most of the elderly people that we've interviewed have family all over the world, in Israel and Germany and America. Yeah, it's hard to say. So really, it's hard to predict the future. It's hard enough to predict the past, let alone the future.
Thanks.
Yeah.
Let me just comment, because you stimulated me, Jeffrey, with your answer to Carol's questions. I noticed in my time in Kiev, in particular, that what you had was an interesting change, in which you had an older Jewish community that, and this was true in Odessa too, it was connected with some of the Jewish communal organizations and the Jewish social organizations, and these are the people, many of whom could speak in Yiddish, so I was able to have, reasonable conversations with them, and they would tell about how the synagogue had been turned into a stable, was one example among other examples of under communist rule, but with the bringing back of some sort of institutional structure, there began to be developed a young professional crew of people who are very Jewishly identified and are in the various things that we're familiar with, the various professions, including entrepreneurial stuff. And it makes you wonder if some of that in time will lead back to other communities outside of the major large ones.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Just exactly. An observation.
Yeah, I couldn't agree more. Yeah.
Victor Miller, thank you for an excellent presentation. I had talked previously with Dr. Veidlinger, and I think these observations are fascinating. I would like to ask you, did you focus very much on the graves in the Ukraine? Because you know, I'm curious even if historians use that as a means of you know, discovering the historiography or the history of the people. It was a fascinating source of information for me. I can carry on, but...
The graves and cemeteries in Ukraine are a fascinating resource, and there's much that one could do with them. Many of them have been destroyed, but there are still remnants of cemeteries left throughout Ukraine. We focus on living people, not on dead people, so it's not actually the mandate of our project. So I can't comment in any great specificity other than I have been to a bunch of Ukrainian cemeteries, and it would be... you know, wonderful work for somebody to go. Really, I'd love for somebody to go and systematically take photographs of graves in these small towns. And somebody did of Beersheb. There's a website that has a photo of every grave in the Beersheb cemetery. But they're not great photos. You can't actually read what's on them, which is the whole point of it. But I think that's a great project, and there's a lot that could be learned.
I'll just tell you, there is a the Jewish Genealogy Society. JewishGen.org has got a project whereby they've got thousands of photographs of graves, and I can put them in touch with you.
Yeah, and I'm familiar with that, but I'd like to see something more systematic.
Oh, you'd like to see it.
But they do good stuff. Yeah. There's also a cemetery database that lists all the cemeteries.
Right. So. Can I just mention one more thing, and that is my own fascinating story is I looked for the graves of my grandfather and great-grandfather and couldn't find them, and then eventually was taken by one of these individuals that looks after the graveyard to what I call a pipe. It was, if you take a pipe and you bury it halfway, and you'll see this just peculiar structure. And I was told that the victims of the 1919 and 1920 pogroms were, some of them were buried in that quote pipe. Mm-hmm. And I was always fascinated. And later on I got a photograph of kids, young kids, sitting around the pipe. I have no idea why. Mm-hmm. Okay, I hope I haven't carried on too long.
That's interesting.
I'm Larry Lawrence. The first lady asked my question. Essentially, I was going to ask if Yiddish is being spoken by any of the younger people, or if, as we always say, Yiddish is a dead language. And also I wanted to ask if it is possible or reasonable for a person like myself who only speaks English, not Russian or Yiddish, to research the shtetls without actually going there, finding a guide, and so forth. I've looked as much as I can on the internet, but sort of the information dwindles after a fairly short time for looking for the shtetl.
Yeah, so there, you know, for looking for a particular shtetl, there's some good websites, Jewish Gen. I don't know if you've discovered that one. And then there are memorial books that were written for many shtetlach called Yizkerbicher. They're mostly in Hebrew or Yiddish, and they've been digitized. Many hundreds of them have been digitized by the New York Public Library. So you can go to NYPL, the Dorot Division of the New York Public Library, and you can find these memorial books that are completely digitized. And again, Jewish Gen has translated some of them. Some are good translations, some not as good translations. And then you can also go there, bring an interpreter. But go there, because I don't think you can get around with English. But but if you could find an interpreter, which there are plenty,
I may
you can get
ask
around.
You for some tips afterwards. Thank you.
I have two quick questions. My grandparents came from Kishinev, and I was wondering if there were any Jews remaining there. My grandmother lived through the 1906 pogrom and was saved by a priest, you know, with 40 Jews in the basement of a church. And one thing I was wondering about, after the Holocaust and the pogroms, is there any observable change in anti-Semitism in those places?
So those are a few big questions. The first one on changes in anti-Semitism, yes. Yes, I mean, anti-Semitism is a strange term because it encompasses so many different phenomena and so many different reasons that people, you know, attack Jews. Anti-Semitism can mean just harboring negative attitudes towards Jews. But I think a lot of the times when Jews are specifically attacked, particularly during the pogroms, it's not necessarily because of the anti-Semitic reasons that, you know, we associate with anti-Semitism, but it's often simply because they can and they believe that there's loot there. They're usually doing it in order to get money and to loot the Jews, particularly during the Civil War pogroms. So it's a complicated question. Anti-Semitism is constantly morphing. And, you know, there's this term, the new anti-Semitism, which is used a lot to describe left anti-Semitism, what they call anti-Semitism of the left today. But actually, the term new anti-Semitism has been used for decades. Since the 1960s, I think that I found an article on the new anti-Semitism. So every few years, anti-Semitism seems to morph and become a new phenomenon.
Are you saying the Holocaust did not cure anti-Semitism at all?
Yes, I'm decisively saying the Holocaust did not cure anti-Semitism. That's the, yeah. And what was the other?
Kishinev.
Kishinev, right. Yes, there's actually a fairly large Jewish community in Kishinev. I've done a little bit of work there, not as much as some other people. But yes, there's a significant Jewish community. It's one of the largest Jewish communities in that part of the world is still in Kishinev.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Steve?
It's in Moldova, yeah.
I'm Steve Silverberg. I wanted to ask about anti-Semitism, too. Frankly, I always heard Ukraine was, well, like Poland, the hotbed of anti-Semitism, and that the Ukrainians, non-Jewish Ukrainians, a lot of them sided with the Nazis because they were anti-Soviet. Then I met a woman, a Jewish woman from Ukraine, and she said, no, it wasn't anti-Semitic. And the other question I had is, how was it for Jews in Ukraine or just the Soviet Union after the war? I mean, you heard mixed things about that, mm-hmm. that they weren't allowed to practice their religion, but no one was. Or were the Jews singled out for worse behavior, for worse treatment?
Mm-hmm. So there's a few questions there. The first one on... What was the first one again?
About Ukrainian anti-Semitism.
Ukrainian anti-Semitism, right. The Ukrainian anti-Semitism. It's a very complicated question. And I think to talk about anti-Semitism is problematic because it can mean so many different things at different times. To talk about a nation being anti-Semitic is also problematic. There were anti-Semitic Ukrainians. There were also Ukrainians who were not anti-Semitic. There were, among the people that we've interviewed, many of them talk about Ukrainians who collaborated, Ukrainians who immediately sided with the Germans who came in. They also talk about Ukrainians who risked their lives to save them. It's very difficult to, you know, decide, are there more who did one, are there more who did the other? And then, you know, as in the example I gave, this fellow talked about a Ukrainian who saved him and then turned him in. So there's a wide variety of different responses.
But there's certain cultures and areas where anti-Semitism was stronger than other areas.
There is, but I think it's difficult to characterize Ukraine in that way. There had been traditions of and sporadic traditions of violence against Jews in Ukraine repeatedly, going back to the pogroms. But that doesn't necessarily mean that anti-Semitism was rampant. It also varies by region. In Western Ukraine, anti-Semitism was used more as public policy than it was in Eastern Ukraine, for instance. So it's a difficult...
I think that's what we want to hear a little bit more about. What was the official, the constituted authorities, mm-hmm. how did they handle yeah. these issues? And did anyone actually oppose anti-Semitism?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, well, you know, the Soviet Union's official policy was to be against anti-Semitism. And by and large, at least before the war, I should say, their official policy was to be against anti-Semitism. By and large, they made anti-Semitism, expressions of anti-Semitism, illegal, and they cracked down on statements of anti-Semitism before the war. That doesn't mean that individuals didn't harbor it. Then during the war, things started to change, particularly after the war. And there was a lot of animosity towards Jews who were returning to these small towns after the war. And this is, you know, a difficult aspect for them, because they thought that the Holocaust was going to eliminate anti-Semitism, or maybe thought the Holocaust would have eliminated it. They came back and see that now they're being accused of having spent the war in Tashkent, having spent the war in Uzbekistan, where many fled the Nazis, or they're accused of not having fought enough, or not having fought in the war. In fact, Jews fought in the war in disproportionate numbers. And Jews were very motivated to fight in the Red Army. That's another experience I talk about a lot in the book, by the way, is the experience of Jews in the Red Army.
The pride of the medals.
Right, and the pride of the medals, and you know, people who fought for the sake of revenge. We interviewed one fellow who said that he said the Germans killed my whole family. The Germans killed my parents. They killed my brothers and sisters. They killed my little brother Motel, he says. But I got even with them. I reckoned with them. I killed more of them than they killed of mine. So Jews were, doubly motivated by this notion of revenge as well. Nevertheless, after the war, they're accused of not having fought as well. They're accused of having fled fled the war in Tashkent. Then Stalin does begin an anti-Semitic campaign around 1946. It intensifies in 1948. It becomes blatantly anti-Semitic right before Stalin's death in 52-53. Stalin allegedly had plans to ship all of the Jews out to Siberia, to gather up the Jews together towards the end of his life and ship them to Siberia. He was discriminating against Jews. He closed all Jewish institutions in the late 1940s. He arrested and killed leading Jewish figures. My first book, actually, is on the Yiddish theater in the Soviet Union. And the head of that theater was a fellow named Solomon Michoels. And Michoels, during the war, became a major spokesperson for the Soviet war effort and was actually sent to America. Right, he was sent to America to campaign for Americans to open up a second front to save Soviet Jewry. And all of this he was doing with the support of the Soviet government. And then after the war, the Soviet government turned against him. He was killed. He was ran over by a truck in what was supposed to have been an accident, but we all know, and we now know for sure, was orchestrated by Stalin. Then everybody else associated with the theater, all of the leading Yiddish writers in the Soviet Union, were arrested and subsequently shot on August 12, 1952. And then in 1953, Stalin started a campaign against doctors and started arresting Jewish doctors, Jewish theater critics, and anti-Semitism, what I call official anti-Semitism, officially began. The Soviet government became officially anti-Semitic at that point. And it's related to a whole bunch of things going on in the world, including the creation of the State of Israel and the new dynamics after the war. The decline of the Jewish population during the war means that Stalin doesn't have to co-opt them anymore. He can now simply try to eliminate them, eliminate any semblance of Judaism in the Soviet Union.
Thank you.
So yeah, I don't know if that answers, but it's complicated.
Please. Oh,
very interesting. My name is Eleanor Bachrach, and I worked for USAID in Ukraine and Moldova from 1995 to 2000. First, I have a geographical question, I guess. I identify Transnistria with the breakaway,
yes,
very mafia,
right,
part of Moldova. Were you only in a Ukrainian part?
Yeah, so I should clarify that. That's a completely different Transnistria.
Oh.
Same name, but different place. The Transnistria that I'm talking about was a Romanian-German designation that only existed from 41 to 44, basically. And the Transnistria that you're talking about is a post-Soviet development. It's in a different location, and
Even contiguous?
Parts of them, I'd have to look on a map. Parts of them, I think, could be contiguous, but it's a different region.
Okay.
Same name, different region.
An anecdote you might enjoy, relevant to what he was, somewhat relevant. A friend of mine came to visit while I was there with a representative of the Joint Distribution Committee, because they're providing aid to a number of the elderly Jews living, I think, in various parts of Ukraine. And they were approached by a couple of elderly people on the street saying, how can we join your group and get aid too?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's a common story. Yeah, and in fact, for aid workers, one thing, you know, a lot of these communities that we went to are very poor and are receiving a lot of aid from international organizations. And I saw the role that these international aid organizations do, and it's really quite remarkable. It's really heartening to see what people are doing and how the world has stepped up to provide for so many of these people in this difficult part of the world. So thank you for what you were doing.
A turnaround. They're now in some ways in better shape than their neighbors.
Yeah, yeah.
Hi.
Hi.
This is our next to last question.
Next to last, oh boy. As you may know, maybe not, the father of the last of the Lubavitch Rebbes lived in that part of the world that's of interest to you. He started out in Belarus and wound up in Ukraine, was a rabbi there, and was taken away, jailed, and sent to exile to Kazakhstan, where I lived and worked, and in fact is buried in Almaty. That's a whole long story. But I wanted to ask you, in terms of Chabad, which is active all over the world in extraordinary ways, if their presence was something that you noticed in some of your visits to these small communities?
Yes, their presence. They have a very strong presence in many of these communities, as do other Hasidic groups as well. Chabad is the most prominent, but the Karlin of Stolner Hasidim are also present there. The Bratslav Hasidim are also present there. But yeah, Chabad also, and they've also done great work. There are some very dedicated Chabad rabbis who have gone over there. And, you know, they don't go for a, you know, one-year stint, a two-year stint. They go for, you know, 20-year stint or so. And they really do, you know, a lot of work and a lot of work on behalf of the people that they're trying
to
help.
Did you notice any kind of turning toward religious observance by some of these people who grew up in a totally secular world?
Yes, the elderly maybe, but it's not a, I think most of the reasons that the people, I mean, we find people in synagogues and these people go to synagogues quite regularly, but they go for a sense of community, I think, not for, you know, not for any religious purposes. And I think Chabad realizes that. And this is, you know, another reason why I've come to really, you know, like this part of Chabad is that they realize that what they're serving is for these elderly people. They're giving them a place to go when they wake up in the morning. They're giving them a little breakfast. They're giving them a community to be a part of. And, you know, the sense of community is so important and, you know, was so important for the people that I talk about. And I think Chabad has, you know, tried to instill that and to continue that.
My name is Arthur Sackley. My family, my grandparents came here from Poland, although they originally, I traced my ancestry back to Lithuania and Brodno and so on. I know that in Poland now, particularly in academia and in the colleges and universities in Poland, they're very much interested in Jewish studies and Jewish life in Poland, mm-hmm. Okay, before that. In fact, even in film, there are films made now about Jewish life in Poland. I saw one a couple of weeks ago called Osteria, recommended for anyone who wanted to see Jewish life 100 years ago in small town Poland. Osteria. I don't know whether it's available. Okay, Osteria is the name of the, was the name of the film. In other words, there's a lot of interest in Poland about Jewish culture. Is that true in the Ukraine now, in, let's say, in universities or in academia, you know, or, mm-hmm. or are people interested in Jewish life before the Holocaust?
Yeah. You know, less so than in Poland, but it's going in that direction. I think there is more and more interest in it, but we're talking small amounts. I think Ukrainians still have yet to totally incorporate the Jewish experience in Ukraine as part of their own history. That, I think, is changing. So Poles for a long time, Polish, you know, young Poles like myself, see the Jewish, former Jewish presence of Poland as a big part of their history and have started to embrace that and problematize it in different ways. In Ukraine, that process is only beginning, and I think it's been accelerated a lot in events of the last few months, actually. You know, Ukrainians and Jews have been separate in many ways, lived in separate areas often, and didn't regard, Ukrainians tended not to not regard Jews as Ukrainian, and Jews tended to not regard themselves as Ukrainian either. Yeah. If you ask who they are, they'll say they're Jewish. They won't say they're Ukrainian, even if they live in Ukraine. And in fact, you know, of the people that we interviewed, I think only one actually identified as a Ukrainian. The rest identified as Jew. That's now changing in the last few months. And I think the revolution in Ukraine has helped instill that, where Ukraine may be, you know, maybe this is overly optimistically speaking, and I tend not to be an optimist, but nevertheless, history doesn't make you into an optimist. But nevertheless, maybe Ukraine now is turning into a nation state that won't be as ethnically based as the nation state of Ukraine was since independence. That there's now an ideology fueling it that isn't exclusively related to Ukrainian ethnic identity, but is now related to, you know, more Western liberalism. And that's an ideology that Jews can embrace. And I think this is why, you know, since the revolution, some of the Jews in Ukraine have been pretty prominent in the revolution and endorsing it.
In other words, they're going in that direction, but it'll take time before they're up to, let's say, what Poland is doing now.
Yeah, yeah, exactly.
Okay. Thank you.
As former teachers, I want to say one thing only.
We want to get your words of wisdom. Come to the mic.
Words of wisdom. I just want to say, you just seen a perfect example of the wisdom of the old rabbi who said, I've learned a lot from my colleagues, and I learned a lot from my teachers, but I learned the most from my students.
Thank you, David.